Good morning, everyone. Katie here with Forbes AAC. Today, I'm going to present our webinar on busting AAC myths. I am a speech-language pathologist and the educational program developer for Forbes AAC. Today, the audio and video should be turned off for everyone attending. So if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat and I can answer them throughout or at the end. We know that there's no, magic button for AAC. It takes time, practice, modeling. A lot goes into successful AAC use. Today, we want to talk about how we can bust some of those myths surrounding AAC by identifying the myths and describing the research that discounts these myths. So we're going to start out with one of the seminal papers done by Romski and Sevcik in 2005. They addressed myths surrounding the roles of AAC that often prevented professionals from including AAC services and supports in early intervention for children with communication difficulties. So they addressed seven major myths. We have myth one, that AAC is a last resort in speech language intervention. Myth two, that AAC hinders or stops further speech development. Myth three, that children must have a certain set of skills to be able to benefit from AAC. Myth four, speech generating AAC devices are only for children with intact cognition. Myth five, children have to be a certain age to be able to benefit from AAC. And myth six, that there is a representational hierarchy of symbols from objects to written words. Since the publication of this paper, there's been increased recognition in both research and clinical settings of the benefits of including AAC services and supports in early intervention. So we'll first talk through all six of these myths that they addressed in their paper, and we'll talk about a few more that have been discounted over the last several years. So first, that AAC should be considered like a last resort. This comes from when AAC was first emerging as an intervention strategy. It was considered a last resort. It was thought that it would be employed only when every other option for successful development of speech had been exhausted. In 1980, Miller and Chapman, they argued that there should be a set of decision rules that indicate AAC was to be considered when speech had not been developed by age of 8 years. It's very late, but that's, where we started then and where we are now, right? We know that children as young as 16 months can benefit from AAC. So since that time, as I said, additional research and information has emerged to change the use of these decision rules. The use of AAC intervention should not be contingent on failure to develop speech or considered as a last resort, because AAC can play many roles in early communication and communication development. It can be utilized in conjunction with verbal progress. If a child has childhood apraxia of speech and we're working on addressing those motor planning and programming deficits in therapy, but we know that they're really struggling to expressively communicate, AAC could be great for them as a way to communicate when there are breakdowns and really be a successful multimodal communicator. We know now that it's critical that AAC is introduced before communication failure occurs, right? We don't want to wait until they have failed and that they're struggling and that they're frustrated and they're acting out. We want to introduce AAC as soon as we see that those communication breakdowns are occurring to make sure they have access to communication. AAC is not only for an older child who has failed at speech development, but it's also should be utilized for young children during the period when the child is just developing communication and language skills. If they are at risk or showing delays, we can use alternate communication options to maximize their communication and prevent communication breakdowns and frustrations. The next myth that they addressed is that AAC will hinder or stop further speech development. And for some reason, I feel that this myth continues to persist. It's the impression that AAC intervention is going to impede the child's speech development. We know that research does not support this. In fact, the literature actually suggests just the opposite. There's a number of empirical studies that have reported improvements in speech skills after AAC intervention experience. For example, a meta-analysis by Miller, Light, and Schlosser from 2006, they found that in the 25 studies they looked at, none of them demonstrated a decrease in speech production as a result of AAC intervention. 11% showed no change, and actually the majority, 89%, demonstrated gains in speech. All users are going to respond to AAC differently. However, through AAC, users can learn language, again, reducing frustrations, communication breakdowns, and we see here that it can actually demonstrate gains in progress in speech production. Next, as they say in this study, in the past, children, there was some sort of expectation that they needed to have a certain level of skills before they could benefit from AAC. It was thought that with some degree of cognitive disability, if a child has a cognitive disability, they might be excluded from AAC intervention in the past. And we know that that's not necessary. We don't need to do that. We don't need to prevent AAC intervention due to an individual's set of skills. Cognitive development is not going to lead to speech development and vice versa, right? While one may argue that some basic cognitive skills are essential for language to develop, the actual relationship between language and cognition is still, you know, up for debate. And so we don't want to have an expectation that one has to be there for the other. We know that some individuals, you know, we might not be able to adequately assess individuals' cognitive abilities due to certain level of impairment, and maybe they aren't able to demonstrate their skills due to fine and gross motor deficits or vision impairment. So we don't want to prevent them from having access to AAC because of that. We need to find a way to get them access, adapt the AAC system for them, and then teach language. Developing language skills through AAC could be extremely critical to these individuals, and it can demonstrate functional cognitive gains as well. The reality is this myth is false. For young children, there is no prerequisites for communication when using AAC supports. Kind of tying into that myth, you know, there once was believed that there had to be a certain level of cognitive skills that a child needed to demonstrate before they were able to access AAC. And there's no evidence of that, right? Individuals who utilize AAC are going to have a wide range of cognitive abilities. They may have cognition that's considered within normal limits, and they might have severe cognitive impairment, but that does not mean they cannot benefit and be successful with AAC supports. There are no behavioral or cognitive prerequisite skills for users that they need to demonstrate before AAC is introduced. Any person with a communication deficit or communication difficulty should be given the chance to learn to communicate with AAC. As we know, there's a lot of technological advances. You know, the joy of living in 2022 is technology changes almost daily. And these technological developments in AAC has provided a really broad range of options available for young children, depending on their cognitive abilities, as well as their other abilities, you know, motor, vision, hearing. There are many choices for AAC devices that go from simple and expensive technology like a single switch all the way to more complex, robust systems. And all of these can be a tool for individuals regardless of their cognitive abilities. Next, this myth, I feel as if it still kind of persists as well, that a child has to be a certain age to be able to benefit from AAC. And we know that there's no evidence that there is a certain chronological age that would optimally benefit an AAC user. Chronological age has, you know, is frequently utilized as an argument against providing AAC services to young children. But if we know a child is at risk for speech and language deficits based on a medical diagnosis, a history of, you know, brain injury, a diagnosis of cerebral palsy or some sort of syndrome, they're demonstrating, you know, maybe some early signs of childhood apraxia of speech, we want to intervene early and often to make sure they still have access to AAC supports to continue to develop language. Kind of ties into that myth from earlier that said that AAC would prevent speech production. We know that that is false, and it ties right into this, that children have to be a certain age to be able to benefit from AAC. We know that that's not true. Some parents and professionals, you know, to this day believe that introduction of an AAC mode at an early age could prevent speech production gains. And we know that that's not true, right? We have to educate them on the research that's out there, on the research that supports early AAC supports for individuals who are at risk for communication deficits. Again, we want to help them maximize their language, and often that's going to be through a multimodal approach. It's not just AAC, it's not just speech, it's not just low-tech picture cards, whatever that may be. They're going to use multimodal communication, and we want to help them learn to maximize that. Current research documents the efficacy of communication services and supports provided to infants, toddlers, and preschoolers, and those are individuals with a wide range of medical needs. Studies have shown that the use of AAC does not interfere with speech development, as we said. And studies have found that young children, you know, ages 3 below, as young as 16 months old, can successfully use both aided and unaided AAC. The last myth suggested in this, you know, seminal article is that there has to be a representational hierarchy of symbols from objects to written words. And people think that, used to think at the time, that it has to begin with real objects to photographs to line drawings to more abstract representations and then to written English words. And that's not necessarily the case. Studies have found that early development of word learning is not specific to a predetermined mode of symbol representation. And a child may do really well with a certain kind of symbol. It's all going to depend on how the child understands and learns language. There is not this hierarchy we have to move through, that they have to meet a certain level at a certain mark before they can move on to the next one. Research has shown that by the time a child is 4 years old, they have already developed an awareness of symbolic function. And at that time, they may be using, you know, various symbolic modes. But again, there's not a hierarchy they have to meet and move through to be able to do this. There's been some great changes, of course, in the last several years, research going into AAC, and we've found that there's even more myths that we've been able to bust, right? And we'll move through those next. But how have these changes come about? Well, we know that there is an increase in access to AAC overall. Technology has changed and it continues to change. Another huge barrier that we've are moving to move past is that there's an acceptance and an awareness of AAC supports for young children. There's not as much pushback anymore. We know that introducing AAC early and often is really going to help these individuals develop and learn language. We also know that there is more individuals who require AAC, and that's for a variety of reasons. We know that there's a rise in individuals diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder. There's improved survival rates for children born with developmental disabilities. You know, children being born at 25, 26, 27, 28 weeks are living, but they may require some AAC supports. I think it's really important to think about the fact that more individuals who require AAC requires us as clinicians to be really aware of that and identifying those who are at risk for possible speech and language development or speech and language deficits and the development of speech and language. And we want to make sure we're getting them access to AAC so they can use that as an additional mode of communication. Another myth, and I hear this a lot, and this is one I work with a lot of parents on, is that some speech may be enough. You know, I've had parents say, well, I can understand them. You know, they can answer with yes or no, and maybe they have one or two or three words, and you know, that's enough. I mean, imagine having to live your life with only four or five words. You know, it's so limiting. And not to take away from the fact that the parent and the child have this ability to communicate with each other. We don't want to take away from that, but we want to educate them that there is a limitation when we're going that route. You know, what they're using with these just few words, it may not be enough to meet their communication needs. So we have to really think about what they're using, their current mode of communication. Does that allow them to speak in a variety of communicative functions? Are they able to speak to a lot of communication partners, or is that limited because of their intelligibility? Another crucial question to ask, does their current mode of communication allow them to communicate about their safety, health, and well-being? You know, if you can only answer yes, no questions, think about how long it would take for you to communicate that your stomach hurts. Think about how long it would take for you to communicate that, you know, you have an earache. If you can only answer in yes, no questions, you're totally reliant on that communication partner that they'll ask the right questions to get to your answer. So if an individual has any unmet communication needs, AAC can meet those needs. Again, always thinking about this multimodal communication for individuals who require AAC. Another myth we have is that a person must master low-tech AAC before using high-tech AAC. We know that's not true, right? We don't typically ask, you know, a child who has typical language and typical speech development, we don't ask them to point to pictures before we begin to ask them to use their verbal communication. We're going to use, again, that multimodal communication, thinking about how they use different modes, speech, sign, high-tech, low-tech, gestures, facial expressions, etc. We're going to have those individuals utilizing those different modes of communication to communicate about their wants and needs. There is no requirement that they master these low-tech systems. I think a great way to think about this myth is that, again, thinking from a multimodal communication standpoint, high-tech AAC, these really robust systems, are going to provide more long-term solutions, but they're not going to replace other forms of communication, right? We're going to have ongoing low-tech nonverbal communication, gestures, facial expressions, etc., that a user is going to utilize to communicate. You know, we are going to print out a core word board, laminate it, and put it in the bathtub so they can communicate there without getting their high-tech device wet. You know, we know that devices can die if we're not by an outlet. So there's a lot of different things that go into this, but the key takeaway is that Mastery of low-tech AAC is not required before high-tech AAC, but we're probably going to use them both, and that's a good thing. We want to give the user multiple ways to communicate across environments so they're really set up for success and for independence in their communication. Another myth, unfortunately, and, you know, as technology becomes more and more ingrained in our lives every day, I think this is fading away, but it's still out there. There's a myth that these high-tech AAC devices are complicated and confusing. The good news is that, you know, individuals, I mean, children, infants, toddlers, up to, you know, my 90-year-old grandma, who I just recently taught to text, they are being exposed to technology at a much higher rate than ever before. And so everybody's ability to get more comfortable with tech is increasing. And there's research that's looking into this, and it's, you know, research has found that high tech is often preferred by users and their caregivers over low tech systems. You know, it's all going to depend on that specific user, but we do want to make sure that they have access to a high tech, robust AAC device, so they have access to a wide range of language to communicate for various different functions. Another great thing about, you know, one of the only good things out of COVID is that more and more things, more and more supports are coming in online forms. So yes, we offer in-person trainings and setup sessions, but we also have these webinars like I'm doing today, training videos, remote support sessions, meeting up on Zoom. There's so many different ways to help teach an individual to use these high-tech devices to prevent this myth from being held true. Last but not least, I would say that this is unfortunately still pretty common in my experience, that individuals think AAC can't be utilized for individuals with really complex motor needs. And we know that that's not true. Individual who has fine and or gross motor deficits, you know, this may impact their ability to directly access a button with their finger. But we know there are so many alternate access methods available to make sure that the user can independently and effectively access their device. The, you know, technology that's going into eye gaze and switches and head mouse control, there's so many options out there, and they're just getting better and better to help these users with complex motor needs access their device and be able to successfully communicate without depending on others. And it's one of my favorite things to work with, is really helping to identify user strengths in terms of their motor abilities and utilizing that strength for them to access their device. It can be really rewarding. And as I said, this technology is just continuing to change and continuing to improve, which is helping these individuals. Conclusion, we know that there is increased recognition in both, as I said, research and clinical settings of the benefits of including AAC services and supports in early intervention. And these continue to bust those myths surrounding AAC. We know AAC doesn't impact speech production development. We know that it should be introduced early to facilitate communication and language. We know they don't have to have a certain age or a certain cognitive level or a certain motor ability to utilize AAC and use it well. All of those myths have been busted. As always, we'd love for you to connect with us. We have an Instagram page, a Facebook, and a Twitter. We also have a YouTube page. So check that out. That's where this webinar will be housed, and you can also access it on our website at forbesaac.com. Check out our website to find your local assistive technology specialist. That's listed on our website under contacts, and you can get in touch with your local rep right then and there. As always, please contact me with any questions or comments. My email is kdt@forbesaac.com. This recorded webinar will be available in about a week's time on our website and on our YouTube page. Stay tuned for emails about our upcoming webinars and feel free to ask any questions at this time.